Good afternoon. The first item of business is portfolio questions, and the portfolio this afternoon is social justice, housing and local government. I would remind members, if they wish to request a supplementary, they should please press the request to speak button during the relevant question or indicate so in the chat function by entering the letters RTS during the relevant question. And I call question number one, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how many affordable homes it has delivered in the past year.
Minister Paul McLennan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scotland has led the way in the delivery of affordable housing across the UK. Latest published statistics to the end of December 2022 show that in calendar year 2022, the Scottish Government, through the Affordable Housing Supply Programme, supported delivery of 9,727 affordable homes, an increase of 1% on the previous calendar year. More than 8,000 of these homes are for social rent. This takes the total delivered since 2007 to more than 118,000 affordable homes, 70% of those for social rent.
Alexander Stewart.
I welcome and thank the Minister for that response. Statistics released last month by the Scottish Government have indicated that the number of new home starts in the last quarter of 2022 have decreased by 24%. The housing market is in an absolute crisis, and without any plans how to address the crisis, things can only get worse, Minister. Projects are being halted due in part to Patrick Harvey's rent freeze. Does the Minister agree that the recent rent cap will negatively impact the delivery of new homes?
Minister.
Yeah, can I thank the Member for that question? I think one of the key things in discussing with the sector itself is cost of construction inflation and the general inflation costs. Construction inflation is at 16%, which has obviously impacted on delivery of homes, both in the social sector and in the private sector in regard to that. So that's certainly the feedback I've had. The market has also slowed down in the feedback we've had in regarding to the massive increase in interest rates. And that's been the biggest influence, I think, we've seen in the slowdown of the housing market.
And supplementary, Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Shetland continues to have a shortage of available housing and long waiting lists for housing association and council homes, and recruitment and retention in key industries and public services is hampered by a lack of available housing. The Scottish Government needs to ramp up the pace to deliver on the promise of 110,000 affordable homes by 2032. How is the Scottish Government ensuring that estimates of affordable homes needed in rural and island areas adjust for the demands of growing industries being attracted to the Highlands and Islands?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think it's an incredibly important point that the Member has made. Of course, of the 110,000 target, 10% of that, at least, we're looking in, of course, is rural housing, which is around about 11,000. We are working on, at the moment, our Remote Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan. And as part of the work that I'm looking to do over the summer, I'm looking to visit as many islands, as many rural areas as I can, and we'd be obviously keen to visit your own community, constituency in that regard. Of course, we've got to look around about the affordability, as I mentioned before, around about the 16% increase we talked about in construction costs, and that's something I'm working on officials with at the moment. But I think we'll see the more detailed work, as I said, in the Remote Rural and Highlands Action Plan. But more than happy, as I said, to visit your constituency during the next few months.
Before I move to question two, which is Bob Doris, I note that the member was not here at the start of the portfolio questions, and I'm sure that he would wish to preface his question with an apology to the Chamber. Question number two, Bob Doris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Indeed, I would have done so without your prompting, but duly noted, and my apologies forthcoming. To ask the Scottish Government how it supports low-income families in Glasgow.
Cabinet Secretary Shirley-Ann Somerville.
Tackling child poverty is a defining mission of this Government. We are providing a range of support which will benefit families in Glasgow and across Scotland. This includes investment in the Scottish Child Payment, 1140 hours of funded childcare, free school meals and in discretionary housing payments which provide direct financial support to people struggling with housing costs. We are actively working with partners in Glasgow to connect families to the services they need to thrive and have committed to tripling our fuel and security fund to support anyone at risk of self-disconnection or self-rationing their energy use.
Bob Doris.
Presiding Officer, I welcome those substantial efforts. In Tuesday's Child Poverty Debate, I suggested the possibility of a school clothing grant twice in a school year, or indeed a summer holiday supplement to the Scottish Child Payment, suggestions which could potentially benefit low-income families at particularly financing times. Cabinet Secretary, given there is going to be an anti-poverty summit, can I ask how the Scottish Government will consider new initiatives to tackle child poverty including the suggestions I have made, and how these will be agreed, of course, as resources are identified.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Bob Dorris for his questions and indeed for the proposals and suggestions he's brought forward. I think the last point of that question, Presiding Officer, is the key point about when new resources are identified, because as Mr Dorris quite rightly knows, one of the challenges that we have is that our budgets are fully allocated. But we do need to look very seriously at new ideas. That's why the First Minister has proposed the Anti-Poverty Summit, and I believe invites are now going out for that, and I would be happy to take those suggestions as read, but if Mr Dorris would like to provide me with more in writing, I would of course be happy to receive that.
Question number three, Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the number of households that have received the winter heating payment in Aberdeenshire.
Cabinet Secretary.
As at 31 March 2023, almost 400,000 low-income households had automatically received their £50 in winter heating payment to support them with their energy bills for this winter. All will have received a letter explaining their entitlement to the benefit. Our first release of official statistics on winter heating payment will be published on the 6th of June 2023 and then on an annual basis in the future. These will include the additional local authority area breakdowns. These will be available on Social Security Scotland's website.
Alexander Burnett.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and we look forward to the local authority breakdowns. But in my constituency, areas such as Braemar and Aboyne have been recognised for having some of the coldest temperatures in the UK, and constituents previously could have received more than triple the current £50 flat rate. So what consideration has the Scottish Government given to those who are now missing out on receiving support they previously had under the UK's cold weather payment?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, one of the challenges of the previous scheme, which the cold weather, the winter heating payments has tried to resolve, is that nobody knew how much money they were going to get each year. It was, of course, weather dependent, and it also did not include aspects such as wind chill factors, and there was a great challenge around where the actual weather stations were that created great challenges for some parts of the country not receiving money which people thought they should be receiving. So what we have tried to do with this benefit is ensure that people know what they will be receiving, when they will be receiving it, so that there is a certainty to what is happening. And I think that's very important when we see the cost of living crisis that has been exacerbated by the Tory mismanagement of the UK economy, including in energy prices.
Question number four has been withdrawn. Question number five, Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on whether older people and social security are priority policy areas in light of a decision not to include these in ministerial titles in the recent round of ministerial appointments.
Cabinet Secretary.
So I am the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, which includes social security. The Equalities Minister, as with the previous Equalities Minister, has responsibility for older people. It is totally clear to anyone that, unlike the UK Government, social security and older people are important to this Government. That's why we are delivering 7 Scottish Government benefits only available in Scotland and mitigating the harm caused by UK Government policies. Our £50 winter heating payment also goes automatically to 400,000 people, including those on pension credit, and we have tripled the full insecurity fund to £30 million to support those in hardship. I would urge the UK Government to match those efforts.
Jeremy Balfour.
With no specific minister responsible for social security, what reassurances can the Scottish Government give us that there won't be any further slippage to the full transfer of devolved benefits?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I think this is the second day in a row we've tried, and I'm going to try once again. I am the minister responsible for social security, and at the time when Ben McPherson was, as a junior minister, made responsible for social security, the Conservatives complained that we had demoted the post, but now we're complaining that it's back at a cabinet secretary level, presiding officer. So I do find this a little bit strange, and maybe finding complaints where none is required. But I hope to be able to demonstrate to Jeremy Balfour in the work that we do, and I hope the work that we do together, that I will be taking very seriously all the issues involved in social security and ensuring that we work towards not only delivering the benefits but also the case transfers as the current timetable suggests.
And supplementary, John Mason.
Thank you. I cannot believe the Conservatives are so worried about titles rather than reality. But I understand that the Scottish Government has recently launched a campaign to make people more aware of eligibility for disability benefits. Can the Cabinet Secretary say anything more about that campaign? Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary.
I think this is a very important aspect that we are determined to carry forward. It's not just having dignity, fairness and respect in the system, but it's also as part of that ensuring that people are aware of the benefits that are there and also an encouragement to apply what they are eligible for. Now, I don't know of any UK government scheme where they proactively encouraged people to apply for disability benefits and ensure they are getting the money that we are entitled to. And that's something we are absolutely determined to do, and I would encourage all members in the Chamber, regardless of which party they're in, to share the work that Social Security has done on this campaign for the benefits of their constituents.
A supplementary, Paul O'Kane.
Thank you very much. In a week where research by the Joseph Rowntree Foundation revealed that the number of people living in very deep poverty has increased significantly in 2 decades, does the Cabinet Secretary at least recognise that the removal of these titles from ministerial briefs does indeed send a concerning message, I think, in terms of the government's commitment in those spaces? And would she also recognise that while she is, of course, a very talented member of the government, it is a huge brief, it is a very varied brief, and having a minister responsible for both older people and social security distinctly would actually be of great help, I think, to everyone involved in tackling poverty.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm quite happy to take compliments when they're given from members of the opposition in particular. But can I say, with the greatest respect to the member, one of the aspects governments normally criticise for is government being too big. That there's too many ministers. Now we seem to be being encouraged to actually have more ministers in my portfolio. Now, while I may welcome that as part of the portfolio, I think, as you can see from the front bench today, we are ably supported by a range of ministers, and we'll be delighted to work together with the member and others in all parts of the portfolio.
Question number 6, Katie Clark.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports that there were 224 eviction cases involving tenants lodged with the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland in the month to 15th March.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We understand that the 224 figure quoted by the member relates to the number of eviction hearings or case management discussions scheduled to take place up to the 15th of March 2023. That's not the number of eviction applications received by the tribunal. Each application can have a number of hearings or discussions and will therefore not be the same as the number of applications received. The Emergency Cost of Living Act doesn't prevent landlords serving a notice to leave or making an application to the tribunal, and the tribunal will still make a decision on whether to issue an eviction order or decree. However, enforcement of the eviction must be paused for up to 6 months, except in certain narrowly defined circumstances.
Katie Clark.
I thank the Minister for that answer, and I'm pleased that the Scottish Government has confirmed the moratorium on evictions plus a rent cap would remain in place until September. However, the number of eviction cases being lodged in a given month actually appears to be higher than before the eviction ban due to various loopholes in the legislation. The ban does not apply to those with arrears of 6 months or more, to social tenants with debts of more than £2,250, or where the landlord chooses to sell the property. Would the Minister be willing to look at whether it might be possible to remove those loopholes and how that would impact on the real situations that tenants are faced with?
Minister.
Well, obviously, we do continue to keep the operation of the Act under continual review and will report regularly to Parliament, as the Act requires us to do. I think the member will recall debates during the passage of the legislation on the question of rent arrears. And I made the case that although the arguments are balanced in some ways, the help that people with rent arrears need is not simply to be stuck where they are, building up ever more unpayable debts. The help that they need is in the form of direct assistance, and that's what the government has made available in other ways. So I think rather than thinking that we go back and unpick the legislation that was passed with the support of Labour colleagues, let's make sure that we continue to operate it as effectively as we can to give tenants in Scotland the protection that they so badly need and which is so completely lacking in other parts of the UK.
Question number 7, Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the recent report by Independent Age, which states that 1 in 7 people in Scotland over the state pension age live in poverty.
Minister Emma Roddick.
The Scottish Government is, of course, concerned about anyone living in poverty and committed to tackling it and recognises the specific inequalities that apply to older people. The Scottish Government has consistently called for the UK Government to provide additional support to assist people with the cost of living crisis. However, the Chancellor has failed to deploy the full range of powers available to him to make a real difference to people's lives. The Scottish Government recognises the pressure on household budgets, which is why last year and this, we have allocated almost £3 billion to support policies which tackle poverty and protect people as far as possible during the ongoing cost of living crisis.
Colin Smith.
Can I thank the Minister for her answer and also wish her well in her new role. Too often there is a misconception that the older people are well off, but the Minister will know that the number of people in later life living in poverty in Scotland has risen by 25% since 2012. So as well as looking at more immediate action to combat this rise in poverty, can I ask the Minister in her new role if she'll give serious consideration to the recommendation in the Independent Age Report and the long-standing call by Age Scotland for the establishment of an Older People's Commissioner for Scotland to properly amplify older people's concerns, including what is all too often that hidden problem of poverty in later life.
Minister.
I absolutely appreciate the concerns that the member is raising, but we do not have plans at the moment to introduce legislation to establish an Older People's Commissioner. There are existing commissions that protect the rights of older people, the Scottish Human Rights Commission and the UK Equality and Human Rights Commission. They already play a role in relation to the rights of older people in respect of age as a protected equality characteristic. In addition, we continue to work closely with the Older People's Strategic Action Forum on a range of priorities for advancing age equality. We are committed to promoting the rights of older people and ensuring that they benefit from all that we are doing to improve people's lives. That is why we provide over £2.2 million to support older people's organisations to tackle the inequality and discrimination and support our aim to support the rights of older people.
And supplementary, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I welcome the Minister to her place. As all MSPs are aware, the state pension is reserved to the UK Government and under successive Labour, Coalition and Tory governments has been one of the lowest relative to wages in Europe. Does the Minister know of any commitment by the Labour Party, which seeks to continue Westminster control of pensions, to significantly increase the state pension, the most effective way of reducing pensioner poverty, or is this just more opposition grandstanding?
Minister.
No, I'm not aware of any substantive proposals from the Labour Party that would reduce pensioner poverty, which was a major issue for older people even before the current cost of living crisis. As the member will know, the levers to reduce pensioner poverty, including control of the levels of state pension and pension credit, do lie with the government at Whitehall. And only with the full powers of a normal, independent country could we properly tackle this, but we will continue to call on the UK Government to ensure that all pensioners are encouraged to take up the benefits they are entitled to in full.
And supplementary, Miles Briggs.
Presiding Officer. One of the facts which sometimes is not taken in this argument around older citizens is the fact that they often are undertaking caring roles in our society, not just of loved ones, but grandchildren, great-grandchildren. So can I ask specifically, when does the Scottish Government intend to deliver the National Kinship Care payment, which government have committed to, and also the extension of a period of time for which carer's allowance will be paid following death of a cared-for person?
Minister.
The member raises a very important point, but I think I will ask the minister with specific responsibility for that portfolio to get in touch with him with a full response.
Question number 8, Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on how it will work with local authorities to ensure access to local services, including leisure facilities, for local communities.
Minister Joe Fitzpatrick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government believes everyone should have access to local services, including leisure facilities, and that help to support the physical and mental health of the nation. will work in partnership with local government to ensure that the people of Scotland continue to receive high-quality public services, but we understand the challenging financial circumstances faced by local authorities, largely due to the cost of living crisis. We have increased the resources available to local government by over £793 million in 2023-24. However, it is for locally elected representatives to make decisions on how best to deliver services in their communities.
Maurice Goulson.
I thank the Minister for that answer. And the Minister will be aware that Dundee has been without a local swimming pool since the Olympia shut down for repair in 2021. The facility was only opened in 2013, and yet taxpayers are now footing a £6 million repair bill. With so much disruption and money at stake, it's just common sense to hold an independent inquiry. So it's bizarre that the SNP-led council refused to do that. Does the Minister agree Dundee residents deserve answers that only an independent inquiry can provide?
Minister.
Thank you. I'm obviously very well aware of the circumstances in Dundee and the challenges that place. I know the council are working really hard to make sure that people do continue to have access to swimming facilities, and are particularly focusing that on making sure that children have the ability to learn to swim using the network of swimming pools in Dundee schools and also the leisure facility in Lochee. But on the point of scrutiny and independent inquiry, the matters have been rightly scrutinised by the Council Scrutiny Committee, which is led by opposition councillors. The convener is the leader of the Labour group, and the two deputy conveners are the leader of the Liberal Democratic group and the Conservative group. So I think if we're asking for an independent scrutiny, then I can't see how an opposition-led committee hasn't managed to do that. That said, absolutely get the frustration of people, and I'm very hopeful that it won't be too long before the Olympia does open.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on social justice, housing and local government. There will be a very short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow frontbench teams to change positions, should they so wish. Thank you.